The most stressful time of year is just about here. No, not Christmas. I'm talking about end of year exams. November is a big month for many teens, and some are already under high levels of stress. In the past decade, the number of young Kiwis on medication for anxiety has doubled. What's changed? Are we pushing them too hard? Is social media taking a toll? Well, tonight we ask how we can relieve the pressure on our kids. Can it start with taking one deep breath? Here's Jahan Kasanada.
Exhale and down.
For the iPhone generation,
the breath is our superpower.
This is what a revolution looks like.
It's not this airy-fairy, sitting around in a circle singing kumbaya. You don't need to be spiritual in any way to do this.
Teenagers swapping their Saturday morning sleep in for yoga.
They'd think, I'm a 15-year-old boy trying to be cool. Why the hell am I going to do yoga and meditation? But then afterwards, kids come up to me and they go, I've never felt that relaxed. You know, kids who've struggled with drugs say to me that they've experienced that same feeling of being high meditating. Slowly, gently open your eyes.
Christina Cabot is a well-being coach, tackling the rise of anxiety in young Kiwis.
Any time you talk to a teenager in school and you ask what's really going on, they're going to tell you they are stressed out.
She's teaching these teens to take back control of their thoughts.
When our bodies relax, it's easier for our mind to relax. I mainly work with marginalised young people, but I also work with young kids who are in private schools and have had all the opportunities in the world. Anxiety affects everyone.
It builds up over time like a snowball, building and building and building.
We know him as a gold medal winning Paralympian. But before his success on the track, Liam Malone was beaten by anxiety.
The thoughts that ran through my mind back then were insanely negative. They were rampant and hard to deal with.
Liam had a tough start in life.
What have you got?
Born with a rare bone deformity, his feet were amputated before he turned two.
I was very lucky with the parents that I had. They just pushed me and pushed me and pushed me.
Liam's gutsy attitude to life even got him on the news.
If kids have a bit of a go at you, how do you deal with that?
Oh, I don't notice them.
He's just a normal kid like anybody else. Sometimes he has to battle a bit harder.
But as he got older, his confidence took a hit.
My dad would frequently come into my room and I'd be crying and he would ask me, what are you sad about? And I'd say, like, why can't I have real legs? Why can't I be like my friends? My first year intermediate was teased a lot. I became insanely self-conscious and so I started wearing pants all the time. The idea of people seeing my artificial legs was what was causing my anxiety.
Anxiety goes beyond everyday stress. It can become a clinical disorder, producing a chronic sense of worry, fear, or panic.
When you're walking into school, you're having this tape playing over and over and over again in your head, that's saying that you won't be able to achieve, you won't be able to, you know, make your parents as happy as you want them to be. It connects with your body and it makes you feel sick.
Does anyone have any questions?
15-year-old AJ has had anxiety throughout high school.
It was hard. My parents having these high expectations for me, as well as looking up to my two older sisters who are highly successful in school. I felt pressure to be as good as them. Does that mean I have to be head boy, you know?
You're taking the ball, you're releasing it from here.
Christina says teens like AJ are struggling under the weight of constant NCEA assessments.
So it's not just exams at the end of term or even at the end of the school year. They have to keep their performance up every week, every day. And then on top of that, you've got your sports practice before school, your commitments after school, and some of our kids don't get home till 11 o'clock at night.
To cope with his anxiety, AJ turned to alcohol, drugs, and self-harm.
At times, I just kind of give up on myself.
Liam also made bad choices.
As a teenager, I was insanely reckless, had a number of car crashes, involved in selling weed at school.
All the while, his mum Trudy was fighting cancer, adding to his worries.
She was someone that I relied on to, you know, give me that confidence to be resilient. I didn't tell her how much I loved her and appreciated her. Even when she was on her deathbed, I couldn't do it because I was avoiding the anxiousness. A few days before my mum passed away, she rung me and left a message on my answer phone. She said, "Liam, it's mum, call me back, I love you." And I never got to speak to her again. I had that chance. I had so many chances. So, hard to not live with that. Yeah. When my mum died, I blamed myself a lot. I had to really figure out how to turn my life around, and it was extremely hard. It was extremely hard.
Liam needed something positive to focus on, so he decided to take up athletics. But that came with its own challenges.
Before I could even think about becoming a professional athlete, first of all, I had to get comfortable with people seeing my artificial legs, and it was horrifying. Before going to the track, I would curl up in a ball in my bed. It would physically make me want to throw up. That's how anxious I was.
Desperate for relief, Liam decided to try meditation.
What I really had to do was retrain my mind.
Research shows meditation calms our nervous system and helps to rewire our brains.
So you just pick an object, and I typically will go for something like a spoon that will reflect something that I can focus on, and begin with your breath, get into a rhythm, and then focus your attention onto the spoon. And the whole point of it is just practicing paying attention.
Learning to focus his mind allowed Liam to succeed on the track.
When you go into a high-pressure situation where medals are on the line, for example, you don't want to be distracted. You can still feel extremely anxious, but you can pull yourself back from that anxiety a little bit quicker.
It's Liam Malone!
Last year, he became a Paralympic champ.
Malone gets the gold for New Zealand!
I'm an elite athlete, and the outcomes of my life are completely different.
He's broken the record of Oscar Pistorius.
The most life-changing event was learning how to practice being mindful.
For some young people dealing with anxiety, they will need to seek professional medical help. There are many, many tools out there. You need to find the one that works for you. I want you to think of someone who has made you angry or sad.
A tool that Christina teaches teens is how to challenge the negative thoughts driving their anxiety.
He doesn't know how much I'm struggling, and he just makes me feel so dumb.
So let's say a young person has the thought that my classmates don't like me. Is it really true? What is their behaviour showing you? That they are trying to prove they don't like you so they can be cool? It's quite empowering for our young people to see that they don't have to believe every stressful thought that comes into their mind, that not all those thoughts are actually true. Breathing in nice and deep. 100% of our young people have reported a decrease in stress and an increase in trust and focus.
However, these tools are not a formal part of our school curriculum.
Teachers are recognising that their students cannot achieve because their mental health is holding them back.
Coming up, students at breaking point.
Has anxiety got worse?
Oh God, yes, absolutely.
And why is social media stressing us out?
I had this paranoia that everyone was judging me. If I was looking at this, I would see a really confident, happy, outgoing person.
She was a model with thousands of fans on Instagram.
People who followed me would have had no idea what I was going through.
But behind the smile...
I'm pretty sure I had a psychologist appointment that day.
Rachel's life was anything but pretty.
So who is the girl in these photos?
A very anxious, unhappy, insecure person.
Rachel's anxiety began in her last year of high school.
Anxiety was like my alarm each morning. I'd wake up at 5 a.m. with really bad stomach pains. I just have to put music in my ears and just try and relax because I could barely even get out of bed. I'd always get this rush of coldness through my body and I'd just feel faint.
She'd just split up with her first boyfriend.
I'd never really gone through a breakup before and then I just had no idea how to handle it. Because I was single, I just felt like I needed to look a certain way for a guy to like me.
So you had tied up your self-worth in how you looked?
Yeah, 100%. And that's when social media was all very new and fresh. Because other people were posting their highlights, I felt pressure to be better than them or as good as them.
Rachel had a high profile on social media, but it led her to feel unhappy with how she looked.
I was so caught up in my own thoughts that I had this paranoia that everyone was judging me and being like, she's bigger in person, she's got more pimples in person, she looks nothing like her photos.
Eventually, she even struggled to leave her house.
The voice of anxiety in your head was telling you what?
You're like this forever.
You're trapped.
You're trapped.
Research shows technology and social media are playing a role in the rise of anxiety.
There's so much pressure now online in comparison to when our parents just had the newspaper and magazines, you know? We wake up and check our social media, we check it in our lunch break. It's just constant pressure.
And the ripple effect is being felt in the classroom.
Has anxiety got worse?
Oh God, yes, absolutely.
Julia Davidson is the principal of Wellington Girls College.
We think that we've got about 10% of our students who have some form of anxiety.
10%?
Yeah, so that's about 140 girls. And that could be from something quite minor up to hospitalisation.
What we're having a look at today is understanding what happens when stress builds up.
Julia says schools are partly to blame.
I think we were putting pressure on students to do lots of assessments, to do really well. You need to get the best grades possible so you can do X, Y, Z, you know, all of that. Was adding to the pressure.
What starts to happen? Bubbles start to rise.
We know that there are worries about getting into the right courses at university. What happens after I've got a degree? Will I get a job?
Look how much I am getting stressed.
When I've got a job, how will I be able to pay off my student loan? Will I even be able to afford a house? It's all compounding.
In the past decade, the number of young Kiwis on medication for anxiety has doubled.
I've had parents in my offices talking about their own children when they're harming themselves, when they're cutting, when they just close right down and curl up in a ball in the corner and won't eat and won't drink and won't talk.
But because of the strain on mental health services, many teens struggle to get the help they need.
So have you got students who are waiting?
Absolutely.
For counsellors, psychiatrists?
Yeah. Yes, definitely.
How long are they waiting?
Some of them 2 months.
2 months to see a psychiatrist?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Julia realised her school had to make some radical changes.
The big thing we did, which was contentious and continues to be, is that we cut back on assessments at level one and two. So instead of students doing maybe 140, 150 credits a year, now they would do maybe 120 maximum.
She even banned her teachers from giving out homework.
So a teacher won't ever say, do this work tonight or complete this assignment in the next month. What they will say is, you know, we've got a test coming up, you might like to do some work for it. So the onus is put on students to think about being independent and think about what do they need to do for their own learning.
Do you think it matters who you go and talk to?
I don't think it does at all.
She also meets regularly with a student wellness committee.
What else do you think is really important?
In some Western countries, emotional resilience tools are taught in public schools from early childhood. Julia says that should be a priority for the new government.
We want students to go on and lead happy and fulfilled lives, and if they're not well, and if they don't know how to be well, they're never going to achieve that.
Rachel found the courage to seek help for her anxiety and was offered medication by her doctor.
I've always said no to medication. I always wanted to dig deeper, find the root cause.
She began seeing a psychologist and learned how to manage the pressures of social media.
I focused a lot on not comparing myself to other people. I've just learned to accept myself for who I am and that I don't have to be like anyone else to be happy.
Rachel works in marketing and is also a lifestyle blogger.
I still want to post good images of myself, but I don't feel the pressure to post every single day.
Instead, she's using her profile to teach others about anxiety.
There's always a story behind the Instagram. Everyone has their own battles that they go through. There's a lot more behind the scenes than a photo that's in perfect lighting and makeup that's just been done.
And rather than escaping stressful situations, she's learnt to face them using breathing exercises and mindfulness.
I get to go to a lot of really cool events and I'm okay with talking to people now. I'm really social again. I think I've got through the worst of my anxiety now because I've got so many tools to manage my stress.
I've let go of the old AJ. I'm glad that I'm not him anymore.
With Christina's help, AJ has got his anxiety under control and now he's pursuing a lifelong dream.
AJ was cast in his school's production of Grease, where he played Danny, the lead.
I want to act more, you know? I want to be on the big screens.
So do you think of yourself as a kind of Samoan John Travolta?
Yeah, in a sense, a Samoan Danny Zuko.
He performed in front of 700 people and he was amazing.
And his biggest fan has even adopted some of his moves.
I walk into the room and she's just sitting there with her eyes closed.
When AJ told me about meditation, I was like, why do you have to spend your time doing that? Wow, that's weird. But then when he told me about how to do it, it really works. That's my exercise every day.
It's really good to see her, you know, use the tools that I've learned. It's been life-changing.
So cool. Well, the Ministry of Education says schools are required to build resilience in their students, but it's up to each school as to how they do it. Christina's charity is called the Kindness Institute. If you'd like to know more, head to our Facebook page. We'll have links to support services there too.